to give you an update on Penn Patterson. Some of you have asked how he was doing. And I have an email here from Ted Patterson that he mentioned to me that I could share with you. And this is what it says. He is doing pretty well overall. I thought I was bringing him to Montana for just a month, but he doesn't want to go back home. I think part of it is that my house is so much more functional for him, all being on one level. I think another part is that he cares that I am with my family, which is really nice. He has two children and five grandchildren here, which is also a factor. And he says, please update the people at church. Blessings to you, Ted Patterson. So Clint is doing all right. He's with, like it says in the email, two of his children live there in Montana, and along with five grandchildren. And so right now he would rather be there. Well, if you have your Bibles with you, turn to James chapter 2. I'm going to be reading verses 1 through 7. James chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. My brothers, as believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, don't show favoritism. Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in shabby clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing fine clothes and say, here's a good seat for you, but say to the poor man, you stand there, or sit on the floor by my feet. Have you not discriminated among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my dear brothers, has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised those who love him? But you have insulted the poor. Is it not the rich who are exploiting you? Are they not the ones who are dragging you into court? Are they not the ones who are slandering the noble name of him to whom you belong? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We pray now that our hearts should be open and receptive to the truth of your word. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, in chapter 1, we discovered the importance of putting spiritual truth into practice. Again, James is considered the most practical book in all of the Bible. And so here, as we continue on through the book of James, we find the application of this theme, putting spiritual truth into practice. We find this theme applied to specific areas of our lives. In chapter 2, the writer addresses favoritism and points out how this practice violates the standard of God's word. This passage can be divided into three sections. The first section is exhortation, found in verse 1. Exhortation strengthens and calls forth renewed commitment. Typically, believers are encouraged to some godly course of action. In James chapter 2, verse 1, again we read, my brothers, as believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, don't show favoritism. Because of the present tense imperative found in the Greek, we know that this verse addresses a problem that is already a problem. This problem is already in progress to the in the lives of the people that James is writing to. The letter was originally addressed to Jewish Christians. We see from verse 6 that they were guilty of practicing discrimination. In verse 6, James tells his readers, you have insulted the poor. So in verse 1, the phrase, don't show favoritism, means stop showing favoritism. Favoritism is inconsistent with faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Practicing favoritism contradicts one's profession of faith. Practicing favoritism does not measure up to the truth that one professes to have or to believe. In simpler terms, it is not walking the talk. It is not walking the talk. When we think of the attributes of God, we usually think of His holiness, His great power, His great wisdom, His love, His mercy, His faithfulness, and His goodness. But another attribute of God that is not thought of or spoken of very often is His impartiality. Human beings are not naturally inclined to be impartial. In other words, human beings are they have this tendency to practice favoritism. People tend to put people in categories, ranking them by their looks or their clothes or their social status or their personality or their intelligence or their wealth. But with God, these things are not issues. And we are to see people through God's eyes. This is what Moses said about God in Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 17. The Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God, mighty and awesome, who shows no partiality. Jesus showed no favoritism. It made no difference to Jesus whether the one to whom he spoke was wealthy or poor, a virtuous woman or a prostitute, a high priest or a common worshiper, educated or uneducated, religious or irreligious, a law-abiding citizen or a criminal. We are also to be impartial. In Proverbs 24, verse 23, we read, to show partiality in judging is not good. Well, the second section of this passage is an example found in verses 2 through 4. James chapter 2, verse 2. Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in shabby clothes also comes in. So here we have a hypothetical illustration. The word fine from the phrase fine clothes is translated from a Greek word used to describe the clothing of a rich man or a dignitary. In the Roman world, it was the proper description of the robe of a candidate for public office. In sharp contrast are the shabby clothes of a poor man. And the Greek word translated shabby normally means dirty or filthy. Well, let's look at verses 3 and 4 of James chapter 2. If you show special attention to the man wearing fine clothes and say, here's a good seat for you. But say to the poor man, you stand there or sit on the floor by my feet. Have you not discriminated among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? The rich man is shown special attention. The rich man is looked upon with favor and given a good seat. In contrast, the poor man is abruptly told to stand there, perhaps in the back of the room or in some other out-of-the-way place. His other alternative is to sit on the floor. Now, the Greek text actually says, sit under my footstool, which probably means sit by my footstool. So the one speaking in this verse has a stool for his feet but the beggar must sit on the floor. Now, the basis for showing favor is terribly wrong. Those acting in this way become judges with evil thoughts. Have we ever thought of favoritism as being evil? It is, according to the scriptures. It is obvious that at least some of the churches to which James wrote had wealthy members, or at least an occasional wealthy visitor. Otherwise, it would have been pointless to warn about showing favor to someone wearing a gold ring and fine clothes. The Greek word translated into the phrase wearing a gold ring literally means gold finger. This could indicate the person was wearing more than one ring. It was a common practice among wealthy people of that day to wear numerous rings on fingers, and it was a sign of wealth. It was a sign of social status to wear many rings on their fingers. And the Roman statesman and philosopher Seneca wrote this, and I quote, "We adorn our fingers with rings, and we distribute gems over every joint." I don't know about the total joint, but every hand, finger, joint, they distribute these gems. The sin was not in the man's wearing a gold ring and fine clothes. Wealth in itself is not sinful as long as it is acquired justly and used wisely and generously. Some wealthy people are really generous people. They are giving people. Nor was it sinful for the poor man to wear shabby clothes. There is no sin in being poor unless a person has become poor by foolishly squandering what he once or she once had. In both cases, the sin was partiality, making a distinction between the two. Now, the sin of partiality, or showing favoritism, is one of the most subtle sins of all. We can show favoritism and sometimes get away with it. But partiality reveals a non-Christian sense of values. God shows no favoritism, and neither should his followers. We are not being asked in this passage to discriminate against the rich. What it is teaching is that rich people should not be treated with any special honor or favor. True value in the kingdom of God has nothing to do with bank accounts or gold rings or fine clothes. In his autobiography, Mahatma Gandhi wrote that as a student, he read the Gospels and the Bible seriously, and he was considering converting to Christianity. He believed that in the teachings of Jesus, he could find the solution to the caste system that was dividing the people of India. And so one Sunday, Gandhi decided to visit a church. He attended the worship service at a nearby church, and he intended to talk to the pastor after the service about how to become a Christian. However, when he entered the sanctuary, the usher refused to give him a seat and suggested that he worship with his own people. Gandhi left the church and never returned. He said, and I quote, "If Christians have caste differences also, I might as well remain a Hindu." Favoritism or discrimination comes in many forms. In our society today, we like to think of ourselves as being open-minded and fair. And we take pride in believing that we look past external appearances and avoid making personal judgment of others. In our country, we like to use personality tests and profiles to determine the potential of job applicants. One of the tools I have used in counseling, personal counseling and premarital counseling, is the Taylor-Johnson temperament analysis profile. It is a helpful tool. But what if Jesus, when recruiting his disciples, had subjected them to a personality profile test before considering them as Christian leaders? If Jesus had had his potential disciples tested through a firm such as the Jordan Management Consultants, what would have been the outcome? Well, this is probably what a letter from Jordan Management Consultants to Jesus would have looked like with the results of the potential disciples' personality profiles. "Dear Jesus, thank you for submitting the resumes of the 12 men you have picked for leadership positions in your new organization. All of them have now taken the personality profile tests, and we have run them through our computers. It is the opinion of our staff that most of your nominees are lacking. They are lacking in background, they are lacking in education, they are lacking in vocational aptitude for the type of enterprise that you are undertaking. They do not understand the team concept. We would suggest that you continue your search for persons with experience and proven capability. For example, Simon Peter is emotionally unstable and given to fits of temper. Andrew has no leadership skills at all. The two brothers, James and John, place personal interests above company loyalty. Thomas, he demonstrates a questioning attitude that would tend to undermine morale. We feel that it is our duty to inform you that Matthew has been blacklisted by the Greater Jerusalem Better Business Bureau. And James, the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, has radical leanings and has registered high manic depressive scores. Only one of your candidates has potential. And he shows great potential. He is a man of ability and resourcefulness who meets people well and has a keen business mind. He has contacts in high places, and he is highly motivated, ambitious, and responsible. We recommend Judas Iscariot as your accountant, your controller, and right-hand man. We wish you success in your new venture. Sincerely yours, Jordan Management Consultants, Jerusalem, Judea." God sees things differently than most people do. The third third section of this passage is an explanation. In verse 5, we read, "Listen, my dear brothers, has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised those who love him?" The early church was primarily made up of poor people, people who were considered poor in the eyes of the world. James is suggesting in verse 5 that the poor are not really poor. They are rich in faith and heirs to the kingdom. The kingdom refers to the eternal kingdom of God. It is important to understand that this verse is not telling us that all people who are poor are rich in faith. Nor does it exclude the rich from the ranks of the saved. God's choice of the poor must not be taken as based on any merit inherent in poverty. In other words, not all poor people are saved and not all rich people are lost. One reason God has chosen those who are poor may be seen in the account of the rich young ruler in Mark 10. There, Jesus indicated that those who are rich find it very difficult to enter God's kingdom because their wealth stands in the way. It is very hard for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. That's what Jesus said. A second reason God has chosen the poor is that the poor have nothing to boast about. Jim Cimbala is the pastor of the Brooklyn Tabernacle in New York, and he tells the following story. And I quote, "One Sunday in our church service, a woman who sings in our choir, a former drug addict with the HIV virus, told a story of how she came to Christ. She described in raw detail the horrors of her former life. A street person named David stood in the back of the sanctuary listening closely." Well, Cimbala goes on to say, "When the meeting ended, I was exhausted. After giving and giving, he said, I had just started to unwind when I saw David, the street person, coming my way." And Cimbala goes on to say, "I'm so tired, I thought. Now this guy is going to hit me up for money." And when David got close, the smell took my breath away. It was a mixture of urine, sweat, garbage, and alcohol. And after a few words, I reached in my pocket and I pulled out a couple of dollars for him and handed them to him. And he says, I'm sure my posture communicated, here's some money, now get out of here. Well, David looked at Cimbala intently, and then he put his finger in Cimbala's face, and he said this, "Look, I don't want your money. I'm going to die out there on the streets. I want the Jesus that this girl just talked about." Cimbala, he paused, and then he looked up, and then he closed his eyes, and he said, "God, forgive me. God, forgive me." And for a few moments, Cimbala stood with his eyes closed, feeling soiled and cheap. But then a change came over him. He began to feel David's pain. He began to see him as someone Christ had brought into the church for that moment. And Cimbala spread out his arms and he embraced David. And he shared with David the good news that Jesus saved. verse 6 and 7, James chapter 2, we read, "But you have insulted the poor. Is it not the rich who are exploiting you? Are they not the ones who are dragging you into court? Are they not the ones who are slandering the noble name of him to whom you belong?" Okay, there are three questions being asked here. Question number one, is it not the rich who are exploiting you? Again, the Greek word translated exploiting is a strong term describing a situation where one is brutally deprived of his rights. The word appears in a number of passages in the Bible that speak of oppression of the poor, the widow, and the stranger. Question number two here in this passage is it not the rich who are dragging you into court? The word translated dragging describes the act of bringing someone into court with force. And question number three, is it not the rich who are slandering the noble name of Christ? The rich were speaking irreverently and disrespectfully of Jesus. So how are we doing? How are we doing in this area of favoritism? Are we walking the talk? Are we judging people by the way they dress? In closing, I want to share a story about Bill, a college student who came to Christ while attending a campus Bible study. His wardrobe consisted of some old blue jeans, a t-shirt with holes, and old tennis shoes. Well, across from the street from the campus was a well-dressed, very conservative church. Bill, since he had recently accepted Christ as his Savior, decided to visit the church right across the street from the campus. He walked in late. The sanctuary was full. It was packed. Bill walks down the aisle looking for a seat. Having nearly reached the pulpit, he realized that there wasn't a seat for him. And so he sat down on the carpet. The congregation was feeling a little uncomfortable by now. And then, from the back of the church, a gray-haired elder in a three-piece suit started walking down the aisle with a cane toward Bill. And the elder was in his 80s. And he approached this young college student. And the whole congregation was watching. And the pastor did not begin his sermon. The pastor waited to see what would take place in front of him. And the elderly man, he dropped his cane on the floor. And with great difficulty, he lowered himself. Sat next to the college student. Well, the pastor started his message by saying, "What I'm about to preach, you will never remember. But what you just saw, you will never forget." Let's pray. Father, help us to see things the way you see them. Not showing favoritism. Seeing others as a part of your creation. Seeing others. people that you love, people that you love so much, that you sent your Son, Jesus, to die on the cross for them. So, Father, if we have not been walking the talk, forgive us. In Jesus' name. Well, this morning we have the opportunity to celebrate the Lord's Supper. You don't have to be a member to participate, but it is important that all of us examine our hearts before we take communion. And if there's any unconfessed sin in our lives, this is a good time to confess our sin.